Good morning, everyone. It's a delight to have you here this morning at this beautiful sunny day here in the season of Epiphany. I'm Jonathan Rooning Shear, Director of Music here at Emmanuel, and we're so happy to have you all here with us this morning. If you're visiting, you're welcome to sign our guest book you can find right there at the back. Any ushers will be happy to guide you towards restrooms and anything else, and we're just happy to have you here today. Many announcements this morning. I'm going to guess Rick has one too, given that he's standing right here behind me, but a couple of quick ones here. There are plenty of updates on information about weather closures, needs for pastoral care, if you'd like to volunteer to be a lector, and prayer shawls in your bulletin. A couple things I want to highlight. It's tea and coffee month here at the food pantry. We're happy to take all of your food donations, but especially we're looking for tea and coffee this month. Speaking of the food pantry, there are 7 bags right there at the back that downstairs, they're right there at the downstairs, that need to be delivered to neighborhood families. This is a very easy ask and donation of your time. These are people who are about 5 minutes away from here. The address is on there. Literally, you just drop it off on their porch and you keep on going. So if you have a few minutes to help get food to people in need after church, 7 bags downstairs. Any youth who happen to be here, stick around after church, and you can see Maureen right there, and Maureen and Pastor Marie are going to be planning up a youth service, so go hang out with them right afterwards. A couple of quick pastoral care updates. We remember the family of Stanley Johnson, whose funeral was here yesterday. Several people have asked about Mal, and just want to let you know that Mal Doyle is out of intensive care. His breathing tube has been removed. He's doing much better. He'll still be in the hospital for probably another week. I agree, Christopher. Good news there about Mal. I'll invite, go ahead, Rick, and I believe Pastor Maria and John. Great. Everyone, come on down.
Yes, good morning. A short announcement. Jack LeBlond has nicely offered to help us learn about RMD contributions this time of the year. And that's a way you can, if you're doing your RMDs in your own financial planning, you can give to the church, a non-for-profit, and save money for everyone. So Jack will be here at the end of the service, right here, hang out for 10 minutes, and he'll give us a pep talk about that. Okay? Thank you.
Good morning, y'all. Hey, Annette. I've got this great food bag. This great food bag was donated to us by Key Food, that is only about a half a mile. It's a great grocery store, only about a half a mile from where the church is. And the reason that I have this bag is that before we came here to Emmanuel, Susan used to collect food from various locations around Windsor for the and deliver them to the food bank that Windsor had. And there is a church there, St. Joe's, and we have a van, and Susan had to go to St. Joe's with an empty van because over a month they would collect so much food that she would literally fill our van with it. And so understanding how that program worked, Susan and I thought we'd bring this program here to Emmanuel and see how it works. And how it works is that after church, it's a once a month thing, after church we give you a bag. And on the bag is what's being collected for the month. And as you know, we're collecting tea and coffee this month. And then all you have to do is get your donation and bring your bag back and drop the bag off in the donation box. And, you know, and then the first of the next month, we'll have another bag for you and we'll do this every month and just see how we can do. The food pantry, Susan and I, we fill 50 bags every week for walk-ins. And so that's 50 bags. We have another 7 bags being delivered here. And part of the problem is that when you're trying to put 5 or 6 items into a bag and you want them all to be the same, you need to have 50 to 60 of an item. You know, and so hence this way, hopefully we'll be able to meet our goals, fill our bags, and do a good thing. So after church, I'll be at the back. And conveniently, because I'm the lay assistant today, so I'll definitely be there. And I'll pass out a bag to anybody who'll be willing to take one. Thank you.
There it goes. All right. I just wanted a reminder that this week begins Lent. Wednesday is Ash Wednesday, and there will be a 7 p.m. service here in the sanctuary with music and communion and ashes. There will also be a very quiet, prayerful service at noon in the chapel, which will just be prayer and the distribution of ashes. So we will not, at noon, we won't be having music or communion. It's just meant to be a prayerful Ash Wednesday midday service. So noon in the chapel, 7 p.m. here. I hope we have the chance to see you all. We center ourselves for a confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who makes everything new, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Trusting in God's mercy, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Holy One, source of our renewal, we confess that we are wrapped up in sin and cannot free ourselves. We have not practiced your righteousness. Our hearts have turned away from you. For the sake of the world you so love, forgive us, that we may be reconciled to one another for the glory of your holy name. Amen. Thus says our God, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. God's mercy makes us new. We are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O God, in the transfiguration of your Son, you confirm the mysteries of faith by the witness of Moses and Elijah, and in the voice from the bright cloud declaring Jesus your beloved Son, you foreshadowed our adoption as your children. Make us heirs with Christ of your glory, and may your Holy Spirit bring us to enjoy its fullness. In your holy name, amen.
This morning is from the 24th chapter of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and wait there, and I will give you the tablets of stone with the law and the commandment which I have written for their instruction." So Moses set out with his assistant Joshua, and Moses went up into the mountain of God. To the elders he had said, "Wait here for us until we come to you again, for Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a dispute may go to them." Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. On the seventh day, he called Moses out of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain. Moses was on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. Word of God, word of life. The second reading is from 2 Peter, first chapter. "For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we had been eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received honor and glory from God the Father when that voice was conveyed to him by the majestic glory, saying, 'This is my Son, my beloved, with whom I am well pleased.' We ourselves heard this voice come from heaven while we were with him on the holy mountain. So we have the prophetic message more fully confirmed. You will do well to be attentive to this as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. First of all, you must understand this, that no prophecy of Scripture is a matter of one's own interpretation, because no prophecy ever came by human will, but men and women moved by the Holy Spirit spoke from God." Word of God, word of life.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus took with him Peter and James' brother John, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah, talking with him. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While Peter was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud a voice said, "This is my son, the beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up and do not be afraid." And when they looked up, they saw no one except for Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Please pray with me. Gracious and holy God, inspire our hearts, guide our heads, and open our hearts to your word, to your call, in your holy name. Amen. Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. We know from today's lesson that these words were spoken by the Apostle Peter right after he had seen Jesus transfigured, right after Jesus' divinity was fully revealed to Peter, James, and John. And Peter's eyes were dazzled by the light of the transfiguration, so he jumped into action, any action, that might preserve this holy moment. Lovable, impetuous Peter, a disciple known for boldness that sometimes bordered on foolishness, whose life was a tangle of daring conviction and earthly fearfulness, faithful insight and faithless ignorance. And Peter was unexpectedly in a position of leadership among the apostles. While he might not always have gotten it right, his faith would eventually lead him to Jesus. Faithful leadership. Faithful leadership, like discipleship, is a process, not a product. It is a journey we undertake, not a destination we achieve. It is a willingness to engage in the tough questions and face confusing situations. It is a willingness to admit we don't always know the answers and that we need help. It is a realization that gifted leadership is not about control, but about listening and partnering and sharing in the decision-making process. It is about being open to new opportunities, daring to explore creative ideas and explore possibilities. Faithful leadership requires us to try new things. It challenges us to be open to the unexpected. It is being Peter to those around us, bold and eager, aware that we could fail, undaunted by expectations. It is about being Peter dazzled by God's presence. It is about stepping out in faith even when we're not certain, even when we're afraid we will fall. It is about trusting the one who is always faithful. Lord, it is good for us to be here. I have a friend who climbs mountains. He told me something that surprised me, that while it might be hard to climb up a mountain, the real danger isn't coming down too fast and falling. Maybe Peter was afraid of what might happen if he came down from that mountaintop. Maybe he was afraid of falling and failing. Mountaintop moments are so powerful, so peaceful, so inspiring that we don't want to leave. We don't want to return to the regular struggles of life in the real world. Like Peter, we think, Lord, it is good for us to be here. And then we might pray, please don't send us back. Perhaps there's no better example of a mountaintop story than when Martin Luther King Jr. gave what turned out to be his final speech. Despite the death threats he had been receiving, in his final speech, he said, "We've got difficult days ahead, but it doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop, and I've looked over, and I have seen the promised land." Dr. King's journey didn't end on that mountaintop. The apostles' journey didn't end on the mountaintop. They came down and shared their faith story, their experiences with Jesus, so that millions of people, including you and I, could come to believe and know God's love. Jesus' journey didn't end on the mountaintop. He led the apostles down that mountain and sent them into the world to serve and share God's love. You, my Emmanuel friends, have been on a journey. You have been seeking God's will for your future. You have been climbing mountaintops and coming back down. You have been challenged, you've been given hope, and you have a new day dawning in just a couple of months when a new partner in ministry comes to share this journey with you, when your new pastor comes to be a part of who you are and where God is leading you. It is my hope that, as is common, when a new pastor arrives, that there's a lot of excitement and energy in the congregation, and there's a lot of willingness to try new things and to share new experiences and to be open to new possibilities, to have that mountaintop experience together as the people of Emmanuel Hartford. But just like Dr. King and the apostles, and most especially Jesus, your journey won't end on that mountaintop. You will have to come down, because we are called to come down to share God's word so others might find faith, to serve a broken world, to help our community, to be part of the advocacy for justice. God calls us to all these things. We are called to let the light and the love shine through us, not only on the mountaintop, but back here in everyday life. It is Jesus that leads us down from the mountain. We are called to come down because there is work to be done. holy work, God's work, our hands, our feet, our voices. My friends, it is good for us to be here.
Called together to follow Jesus, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Embolden your church as it witnesses to the majesty and mercy of your Son. Equip lay preachers, deacons, and pastors. Move us to share our stories of your faithfulness and forgiveness. May our lives proclaim your greatness. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Dwell with your whole creation from the tallest mountain peak to the deepest valley. Bless the work of conservation organizations and protect vital habitats. Support the work of disaster relief agencies around the world. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Guide and give wisdom to all in authority. our mayor and local leaders, our governor and state legislators, our president and national legislators, bring freedom and justice to all nations. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Give shelter to those lacking safe homes. Spur communities to work for fair housing for all. Protect our neighbors whose dwellings do not keep out dangerous cold or heat. Accompany with your touch those who are homebound, sick, or isolated, especially Carol, Karen, Chris, Melissa, and Susan, and Louise, Lee, the Jennings Marzette family, McKenna, Brooklyn, and Irving. Elaine, Monique, Rayanne, Sierra, Harris, Orlando, Letitia, and Holly. Vito, Bertel, Teresa, Carmeline, Sadisha, Rachel, and all those we name now aloud or in the silence of our hearts. Merciful God. Make us eager to receive your word in Scripture. Help us recognize Jesus' voice in the needs of our neighbors. Make us confident to follow the way of the cross. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Receive our thanksgiving for the holy ones who have guided us in faithfulness and gathered even the unlikely as your people. With our forebears in faith, and all who have hoped in you, teach us to wait with courage until the promised day dawns. Merciful God, we bring to you our needs and hopes, O God, trusting your wisdom and power revealed in Christ crucified. Amen.
May the peace of Christ be with you always. So with you.
Let us pray. Liberating God, you break the bonds of injustice and let the oppressed go free. Receive these offerings in thanksgiving for all your works of merciful power, and shape us as people of your justice and freedom. You we magnify and adore, through Jesus our Savior. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty, and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and blessed it and broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, and again he gave thanks and praise. And he gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this and remember me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. All are welcome at the Lord's table. You are invited to join us for the holy meal. Thank you. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen. Let us pray.
Holy One,
we thank you for the healing that springs forth abundantly from this table. Renew our strength to do justice, love kindness, and journey humbly with you. Amen.
I'd like to invite the council forward, and everybody else, please take a seat.
Would those who have been elected by the congregation to positions, the Apostle Paul writes, there are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit gives them all. There are different ways of serving, but the same Lord is served. There are different abilities to perform service, but the same God gives to everyone ability for particular service. The Spirit's presence is shown in some way in each person for the common good.
You have been elected to positions of leadership and trust in this congregation. As such, you are called to see that the words and deeds of this household of faith reflect our Lord, in whose name we gather. You are called to work together with each other and with all the parishioners of this faith community, to see that the worship and work of Christ are lived out here in this congregation, and that God's will is done in this community and the world. You are called to be faithful and diligent in your specific area of serving, that the one Lord who empowers you is glorified. You are called to be examples of faith, active in love, to help maintain the life and harmony of this congregation. On behalf of your sisters and brothers in Christ, I ask you, are you ready to accept and faithfully carry out the duties of the office to which you have been elected? If so, please say yes, and I ask God to help and guide me.
Yes, and I ask God to help and guide me.
People of God, will you support these, your elected leaders, and will you share in the mutual ministry that Christ has called us to offer to each other? Please receive. I now declare you installed and commissioned as council members of our Emmanuel congregation. May God bless you with the Holy Spirit, that you may prove faithful servants of Christ. Amen. Would you please rise? May the God who faithfully brings forth justice and breaks the oppressor's rod bless, strengthen, and uphold you today and always.
Amen. One final announcement. Please join us downstairs for coffee hour. And Terry Dwyer asks that if you're inclined, she could use it for more people to sign up for coffee hour. The sign-up sheet.